Dear colleague, welcome to this course regarding accuracy and misplaced electrodes. This course is based on the lectures above: why are electrodes misplaced, improving accuracy, compensating for deviations, and lack of effect due to misplaced electrodes. Let us start with the background. This was also mentioned in the course Targeting in Stereotactic Functional Neurosurgery, but it is worth repeating. Suboptimally placed electrodes is today a huge problem. In this recent study of more than 28,000 DBS procedures in the USA, up to 34% of the procedures were identified as electrode revisions, most often due to improper targeting and lack of effect. This study is very important since it is a snapshot of the actual reality, not including only high-volume academic centers. Further, many patients with misplaced electrodes will of course not be offered a revision and are thus not included in the revisions above. So, when is an electrode misplaced? We have often heard the statement that a deviation of 1 mm is often well tolerated, 2 mm sometimes, and 3 mm seldom. I believe this to be quite true. However, in reality, misplaced electrodes are often very misplaced before revision is considered, as seen in these two studies by the group of Auken. 46% of patients with a suboptimal effect of DBS were demonstrated to have misplaced electrodes, and these were misplaced with on average 6 mm. This is also in accordance with my own experience. I often get second referrals due to poor effect of DBS, and in most patients this is due to misplaced electrodes, and these are often 5 to 10 mm away from the intended target, as seen in these examples of intended STN DBS. It is also important to realize that the VIM and the STN are easy and forgiving targets. The VIM is easy since it cannot be visualized and we have to rely on atlas coordinates. The STN is easy since it is so easy to visualize. They are further forgiving, at least in patients with tremor. If you target a patient with essential tremor in the VIM but end up in the STN, you will probably have a happy patient. Likewise, if you target the STN in a patient with tremor-dominant Parkinson's disease, but end up in the VIM, or in the caudal zona inserta, or in a number of other closely related areas, you will still have a quite happy patient. Other targets, like the GPI or the anterior nucleus of the thalamus, are not that forgiving. If you miss the target, you will get a poor effect. So, why are so many electrodes misplaced? We will in this course focus on electrodes which do not end up in the intended target due to inattention to details and procedure-related deviations. We have already discussed inaccurate targeting in the previous course regarding targeting in stereotactic functional neurosurgery. And we will in the next course discuss incorrect interpretation of intraoperative evaluation. Regarding inattention to details, this is when the surgeon set incorrect frame coordinates or the wrong depth on the instrument carrier or electrode, etc., etc. This is perhaps not a large problem, but it's surprisingly common, and it is best dealt with by simplifying and standardizing the procedure. A more common and important problem is procedure-related deviations from the intended target point. In scientific reports from high-volume centra, the mean deviation from the intended target point has been about 1.5 mm. And thus, many electrodes will be even further away from the intended target. These deviations can be a serious problem, but it can be minimized. It is due to inherent limitation in the stereotactic frame, brain shift, fusion error, MRI distortion, and many other factors. In order to hit what we are aiming at, we need an accurate stereotactic frame, accurate images of the target and frame, an electrode not deviating from the intended target, and a target that is not changing its position. Regarding stereotactic frames, we know that there are differences between different frames. But regardless of which frame you're using, the most important thing is that you learn to know your own frame. There are inherent differences between individual frames of the same model. And since you do not know the other factors that contribute to the final deviation from the intended target, it is not possible to decide exactly what is caused by the frame. But if different frames of the same model exhibit different patterns of deviation in the hands of the same surgeon, then you can conclude that these differences are likely to be caused by inherent differences in the frames. I have myself three Lexell G frames, and each one of them has its own pattern of deviation. You cannot affect inherent factors in the frame, but you can become aware of their existence, and known systematic errors can be compensated for, as will be discussed further down. We can of course use a phantom in order to evaluate the accuracy of the frame that we are using. Unfortunately, this does not take into account the distortion of the frame which can appear when the screws are applied to the head. This appears if the screws are tightened too much, and it's most pronounced if the screws are applied to the more slanting areas of the skull. This can quite easily be demonstrated using a model of the head. We do not see the position of the frame on CT or MRI. We calculate the position of the frame based on the indicator box, and the indicator box must be correctly applied on the frame. If not, the frame will not be exactly where suggested by the indicator box. And the poor position is most often caused by torsion in the frame or by hair between the box and the frame. There are of course numerous ways to incorrectly handle the frame, and this is discussed in detail in the surgical lectures. We further need accurate images of the target and frame. Concerning MRI distortion, today it should not be difficult to find MRI investigations with limited distortion. The MRI distortion for the investigations you are using can be measured using a MRI phantom. And it's important that you involve the MRI physicist in optimizing the investigations. It will be easier for the MRI physicist to help you develop accurate MRI investigations if you explain in detail what investigations you need and why. MRI distortion is or should today be a limited problem, especially when using distortion correction algorithm. Regarding merging of images, when we merge different MRI investigations and CT scans, we will not get a completely accurate merge. With a good protocol, it is possible to get a good merge, but with a poor protocol, this might be a source of large errors. There are many variables, and it is necessary that you evaluate how accurate the merge is with the protocol and equipment you yourself are using. Even with a good protocol, merging of pre- and post-operative images can be a problem if the brain itself is distorted. Since intraoperative distortion due to brain shift is not linear like this, or like this, it is non-linear, affecting different parts of the brain in different directions and to different extent. And the more pronounced distortion, the less accurate the merge. This problem can be managed by minimizing brain shift, as will be discussed further below. We of course need an electrode not deviating from the intended target. We're using a radio frequency electrode to make a channel for the permanent DBS electrode, and we need to have one of sufficient stability. We're using the so-called Harris radio frequency lesion electrode from Elekta. The proximal shaft is wider in order to provide stability, while the distal part is narrow in order to reduce tissue damage, and the tip very rounded and blunt to minimize the risk for blood vessels. We make a burr hole, durotomy and corticotomy centered around the electrode so that neither bone, dura or pia will interfere with it. If the electrode touches the bone, dura or pia, this will exert a force on the electrode which might cause it to deviate. We see here to the right an example where the corticotomy was not performed correctly and the electrode tip is pushing the cortex down. We can also see a video. Here we see the electrode trying to force its way through the cortex, and of course this might cause the electrode to deviate. For the same reason, the trajectory should enter a gyrus close to the bone and not pass through sulci or through the ventricle. If you need to pass through the ventricle, then it's better to have a clean entry rather than sliding on the lateral wall. Other structures might have a similar effect. It seems as if there is a tendency for the electrode to deviate in a characteristic way for the different targets. This is probably due to interaction with various internal structures of the brain, such as the internal capsule. This can of course not be avoided, but it can be compensated for, as will be discussed further down. It seems as if typically the electrode will in the STN, zona incerta, VIM and ventral tegmental area deviate in a posterior medial fashion. In the GPI, the deviation will be smaller and mostly in the posterior direction. In the bed nucleus of stria terminalis, it will be larger and almost only in the posterior direction, while in the anterior nucleus of the thalamus, it will be in the anterior direction. In this last example, it is probably because the electrode is sliding on the floor of the third ventricle before actually entering the nucleus. Regarding the other targets, it is more difficult to understand, but probably it has something to do with the internal capsule. It is also possible that the differences in accuracy between different targets is dependent on the angles used for reaching the target. When aiming for the GPI, one will typically have a very steep angle going right down to the target from a laterality that is about the same as the target, while using a wider angle from a more lateral entry point when aiming for the more medially placed target in the collar zona incerta. And all things equal, I will for that reason prefer to have a steep trajectory. Finally, we need a target that is not changing its position. We want to avoid brain shift when CSF is leaking out, air is entering, and the brain is changing its position. This leads to a reduced accuracy in electrode implantation and several other problems as well. So, how can we minimize brain shift? One of the most important steps is probably to position the patient in a horizontal position. We need to take gravity into account. If we target the lying brain, but we implant the sitting brain, then there is a risk that the electrode might end up somewhat too high and too posterior. The reason why I used to implant the electrodes in a semi-sitting position was that I wanted to avoid CSF leakage. Paradoxically, when I started to implant the patients in a horizontal position, the CSF leakage was much reduced, since the brain is pressed towards the burrowhole site, thus effectively sealing it. And in general anesthesia, with a slight positive pressure, the brain will further expand somewhat, contributing to this effect. And of course, for this to happen, it's important that we choose a trajectory through a gyrus close to the bone, so the brain will be pressed against the burrowhole. The most important thing is probably to reduce the time the dura is open. Either a small opening of the dura using monopolar diathermia, and the dura is normally open for less than 2 minutes before it is sealed using tissue glue. Here we see how I introduce the radio frequency electrode in order to create a channel for the permanent DBS electrode. I remove the radio frequency electrode and gently introduce the DBS electrode into the channel. When this is in place, I seal the burrowhole using tissue glue. Typically, by using this technique, we will not see any air or brain shift after the procedure. These measures taken together will reduce brain shift and hence the risk for misplaced electrodes. However, when you have optimized everything you can regarding accuracy, you will still not be spot on in your intended target in most cases. But you can analyze the remaining deviation in order to find if it is systematic and hence to some extent predictable. And this information should be used in order to correct your targeting according to your expected deviation. We measure the deviation from the intended target, and systematic deviations can be compensated for. The causes to this inaccuracy is most often impossible to specify, but you can compensate for this inaccuracy when you are deciding on the target. The more details you gather, the better predictions you will be able to make. We modify the target based on the expected deviations. In this example here, I know that I am likely to end up in the yellow spot if I aim for the red spot. We modify the target according to this, but also in accordance to the consequences of deviations in different directions. For example, here in the caudal zona inserta, a medial deviation of 2 mm will not be a problem, while a lateral deviation might get you too close to the internal capsule. In the final lecture in this course, you will read about how to manage misplaced electrodes. And with this, I end this presentation and thank you for your attention.